number of elements in H here is 1, which means that H is a terrace subgroup. Or there's the same number of elements, it has the number of elements as P, which means that H is G. Okay, so we've got not so many subgroups. And so, now let's take any element with A being element in G, which is not a neutral element. Then, if I take a subgroup, a cyclic subgroup generated by A, this is a subgroup of G. And it contains an element which is different from 1, so which is different from H, different from the trivial subgroup. So, by what we have just said, it follows that H subgroup is equal to the whole. Okay, and so G is different. Okay, so this was just a simple statement. So much for the moment about groups and subgroups and the cosets and the quotient set by subgroup. So, are there any questions for this or comments? So is there anything, have I already told you until now, anything that you didn't know before? Or not? Come on, buddy. Anyway, okay. Nothing new. But is it okay all the same? Or, I mean, I hope you very soon come to some room. I'd love to meet forever. I mean, if somebody has studied everything, then there'll be nothing new. But I think, so now we want to talk about normal subgroups and quotient groups. So, if G is a group, and H is a subgroup, we have the quotient set G mod H. And, I mean, the natural thing that you could ask yourself is this, again, a group? Is this, in a natural way? Way means, if one wants to do the obvious thing, and it should become a group. So what is the obvious thing? I mean, it's kind of clear. So we would want to define, the group structure on this quotient set by saying that AH times BH, we would want to define this as A times B, H. Now, obviously, but as I told you, this again is a definition in terms of representatives, so in order for this to be a valid definition, we would have to see that it's independent of the representative. So, we have to see. To make this into definition, it should be independent of representatives. And so we can ask ourselves, otherwise it's not definition, but just nonsense. So, let's see. So let's check. So the point is that, that we'll see, is that this will not always be well defined. So in general, this will depend on the representatives, and so it's not definition. But if you put an extra condition on the subgroups, which makes them subgroups we call normal subgroups, then this is well defined. So we can easily see that we need some condition by looking at some examples. So, for instance, if you put what we want. A, so that A equal to the 1. So what we want, so thus we need. That if AH is equal to BH, that will be prime H, and BH is equal to B prime H, then it follows that A, BH is equivalent to A prime B prime H. So let's just look at an example. So assume that we take A to be 1, A prime to be H, which is certainly fine because they are A, 1, and any element, and this is an arbitrary element in H. And we take, say, what we do. We take B, any element in G, an arbitrary element, and B prime equal to B. So we look at just one special case, get some, to see whether already here we find the condition on H. So we want that in this case that AEH, so BH, is equal to A prime B prime H, so this is HBH. And B is an arbitrary element of G and H is an arbitrary element of H. So in other words, that exists an H prime, an H such that HB, so this one is equal, so it's not easy to distinguish, but anyway, HB is equal to B, H prime. But if this is the case, it follows that I can multiply by B to the minus 1 on this side, so it follows that H prime is equal to B to the minus 1, H, B. So in this case, but remember that B in G was arbitrary, and H in H was arbitrary. So we actually have our condition. Namely, we have that for all H in H and all B in G, we have that if you want B to the minus 1 HB is again an H, or I can replace B by B to the minus 1, we want that B, H, B to the minus 1 is an element in H. So in order so that we have a chance, and we have a group, this gives us a group structure on the quotient, but in order so that we have the smallest chance that there is such a group structure on the quotient, we need this condition. And groups which subgroups which satisfy this condition we call normal subgroups. And then we'll see that this condition is not sufficient.
Then we can compute, if you look at this element, 1, 2, 3, 2, 1, 3,
attend on my flight with this element here, no? And I might fly with the inverse of this element. But remember that the inverse of this element is the element itself. And we can just compute. So this would be 1 goes to 2, 2 goes to 3. I'm not yet finished, to 3. D goes to 3, so I actually was finished. Then 2 goes to 1, 1 goes to 1, and 1 goes to 2. And 3 goes to 3, 3 goes to 2, and 2 goes to 1. And you see, an element which is not an element in H. So we have found that indeed this is H is not an abnormal sum. Okay. That's what happened. Yeah, then long bit. Well, maybe I can still try. So now we want to actually show that what I, what was the purpose of defining a normal subgroup, namely that if we divide by it, we still get the quotient set as a group, that this actually is true. So maybe I'll call it this way, one proposition. So let G be a group. And H in G be a normal subgroup. Then the quotient G mod H is a group with the obvious group law with multiplication. A H times B H is equal to A H. And then, so this is quite simple. We only have to prove that the product we're defined, in some sense, we essentially already did this when we motivated the definition of normal subgroup. But let's do it properly. So we take some elements, like A, B, the elements in G, and then we can see A prime, B prime, the elements in G, and then A with A H is equal to A prime H, B H is equal to A prime H. So that means that A is equal to A prime times H for some small h and h, and B is equal to B prime times H prime for some h prime in H. Well, and then we want to somehow